In this video, I'd like to introduce you to Create-ESP32-App, and this is the fastest way to create a Visual Studio Code ESP-IDF project. The project itself is hosted on GitHub under mayor/create-esp32-app. And if you scroll down here, you can have a look at all the various different documentation, as well as the prerequisites, the run commands, and everything else like that, which we'll walk through in this video. Now, if you've been following along in this course, then you have the ESP-IDF installed. If you haven't, go ahead and have a look at the previous videos as to how to do that, because that is a requirement. You'll also have Visual Studio Code installed. The one thing that you will need for this to work is Node.js. Now, if you're not sure whether or not you have Node.js, go to a command prompt and just type node-v. So at the moment, I've got version 12. Anything above version 10 should be fine. Anything below version 10 might also work, but I haven't tested it. If you don't have it, simply go to nodejs.org and download the recommended version, recommended for most users. That should be fine. Node.js has a package manager included inside it called NPM, or Node Packet Manager, and a version of that is called NPX. NPX allows you to actually install NPM packages remotely. So what's very nice about Create-ESP32-App is that once you've actually got Node, you don't need to do any more installation. The package will automatically download. So I'm going to say Create-ESP32-App. So NPX Create-ESP32-App. And right now what it's doing is it's basically giving me some information about the IDF paths, which I will get to in a moment. I'll tell you exactly how that works. But right now it's asking me for the project name. So I'm going to say test1, just as an arbitrary name. Now, it's asking me for where the ESP-IDF is installed. If you've been following along, this will be your default path. If you haven't been following along, or if you've got the ESP-IDF in a different location, you can simply set the IDF path as an environment variable, whether you're on a Mac, a Linux machine, or a Windows machine, and your default path will automatically be the first one that shows up. To select it, I'm just going to hit Tab. If that is not the one I wanted, then I could just go ahead and start typing, and it'll automatically do some IntelliSense to figure out what I'm actually wanting to do. So that's where my IDF path is. Now it requires the extension tools, which is essentially in the .espressif directory. So again, defaulted to c:esp tools.espressif, and this over here is the environment variable path for that. So if you've got that set, it'll automatically pick that up and give you that as the first option. So again, I'm just going to press Tab. So I'm going to actually start that again just to show you what your normal flow would be if you've got that set up, or if you've installed the ESP-IDF at that path and the tools at that path. So let's just cancel that, and we're going to clear that, and let's just run that again. NPX create-esp32-app, test1, tab, okay. And then the last thing it's asking me is if I want anything in addition in my project. I'm just going to press enter because I don't. Now I can go to cd space test1, and I can write code dot. Now, this code dot over here will open up Visual Studio Code. And in some environments, specifically with Linux and Mac, it may not work initially. If it doesn't, go and Google open code from terminal Mac. And over here at this particular result, you can see some instructions as to how to get your VS Code working on the command line. So I'm going to say code dot, and that will now open up Visual Studio Code. Inside my Visual Studio Code, I can see this main directory, and inside the main directory, I've got this main.c. Now, as it is set up the way it is, right, if I want to say hash include, and then I say ESP, you'll notice that it's got all the ESP headers in here. So that's essentially given to me. In addition to that, if I come in here and I say print, you can see that it's giving me full IntelliSense, and I press enter and I press open bracket, it's telling me what it's expected and what it's going to return. As we go throughout this course, we'll see some more tricks as to how you can work with this particular environment like this. Now, in addition to IntelliSense, right, if I make an error, such as let's go ahead over here and say hello, and I can see this little red squiggly over there. You can see that if I hover over it, it's saying expected a semicolon. So I've left something out. So let's go ahead and complete that, and you'll notice that little red squiggly disappear. Okay, so IntelliSense is built in. It's got some pre-compilation in terms of rule checking for C, which is very nice. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up a terminal inside my VS Code so I can run some commands. So what you can do here is you can press F1 and you can type terminal. And the one I'm looking for is this create new integrated terminal. So I'll click on that and I can see this thing pop up here. Okay. The other way to do that is I'm just going to can that. The other way to do this is to press control backtick. Now backtick is this thing on the keyboard. It's the same key that looks, that has this funny little squiggly thing called a tilde. So if I press control tilde or control backtick, it opens up this terminal shell. And you'll notice it says to me over here, do you allow this workspace to modify your terminal shell? And it's going to run this particular script. And you can see where it's pointing. Create-Esp-IDF exports.bat. If I say allow, nothing seems to happen. But if I go ahead and close this by pressing the trash can, by the way, don't press the X because that just closes the panel. It doesn't actually close the terminal. So I need to actually press the trash can that kills the terminal. And now if I open it up again, control tilde or control backtick, you can see it's now loaded all the environment variables into the shell. So just make sure everything's saved by pressing over here, control S, and then come in here. All right, and if you've got your chip plugged in, then you can type the following command, idf.py flash monitor. I've got it set to a keyboard shortcut, and then you can just press enter. This does take a little bit of time, so I'll see you in just a moment. So here we can see that it's done hello world. Now, if I want to kill this terminal, I'm going to press the control close square bracket. So control that thing, or the same key as that. So I'm going to come to here and say control that, and it's going to then terminate that shell. Just by the way, if I run this again, it's going to be much faster. As you can see, it's already flashing. So it really only takes a long time the first time you run it. Now, before we close off, I just want to show you one other interesting thing about this particular template. So I'm going to close this and go back to my terminal, and I'm just going to go one directory back. So I'm back to my project directory. I want to actually install this thing, and I'm going to run that command again. So npx create-esp32-app, and this is going to be test2. I'm just going to move this up a bit. And then press tab. At this point in time, I'd like some additional things in my project. So I'd like some debug helpful files, which we will discover in a later module. Blinky, which we'll also discuss a bit later, and menu config as an example, okay? So I've got these three things selected, and as time goes on, I'll probably be adding a few more down here. And then it's gonna press enter. Let's go into test two, and let's run code dot. And here we can see this debug folder over here. And in addition to that, if we go into main and we have a look at main, we'll notice that we now have some code called Blinky, which goes ahead and blinks an LED. We also have some configuration over here. And don't worry about the squiggles at this point in time. It's just because we need to actually compile it. It hasn't been built yet, so we might need to build it and then close the project, reopen it, and then those little squiggles go away. But still, as it is, we still have full IntelliSense. So if I say GPIO, we can see all the GPIO stuff, the general purpose input and output functions. If I make a mistake, then we can see there's a problem over here, and there's as expected a semicolon. Put that there. So this is not to go through this particular code or understand what this code is doing, but to understand the template, how it works, how it adds additional code to our project, and how we can quickly get up and running. Now, if you're having trouble and if you see a whole bunch of squiggles underneath here, or if you would like to get a better understanding as to how this project works with IntelliSense and everything else like that with the command line installed, then we'll have a look at that in the next lesson.